Are you happy now? There's nothing left to say. So I shut my mouth. So won't you tell me, babe? Are you happy now? You're the only one who can up and run. Make me just as empty as the day you came. You hold all the cards, all the broken hearts, strung over your shoulder till it's all in vain. And only you know the strength in your teeth, the wash and the weight of your pockets so deep.
Awesome. Welcome, everybody. As every Zoominar, people are probably trying to remember where the link to this is. So I know we'll probably have some people joining us along the way. But thank you, everybody that is on time and so far. And as I know, Dave has tons of jam-packed information. So I want to make sure to minimize any downtime so that he can take over and you guys can take advantage for being on time. But I do want to start off before we, you know, introduce Dave here. I do want to say a huge thank you to our sponsors, right? Guys, I know, you know, if you've been in real estate long enough, you know, there's always going to be probably some sponsors or some shout outs, you know, to some vendor partners. And, but really they make these things possible, right? They're supporting us both, you know, financially and by being there for us, to be able to bring on Dave and put on this awesome class for you guys to enhance your listing presentation skills. And so, first I really want to give a shout out to, both of our sponsors. Sandy may be jumping on a little bit later and I'll be sure to give her a little bit of time there, but both Sandy is with Fairway Independent Mortgage and she's been a partner with our market center for years, and I can't tell you how much really appreciate the job that she does. Some of our top teams use her as her lender and she knocks it out of the park, right? She is working those deals, you know, that sometimes other people may be saying no to and really hand-holding the client. So really huge thank you to Sandy, because really, I can't tell you, I actually used to be in mortgages myself prior to being on the real estate side and switching over from the evil side, right? So I enjoy it much more as a real estate agent is what I'm getting at. But, you know, we need that side. They are a necessary partner in our world. And repeatedly, Sandy has shown up, not just for our market center, but for our agents. So really huge thank you to her. So if you have a buyer that you're about to work with and would love to experience that, you know, with them, just give Sandy a call. Her information is there on the screen. And what I'm going to do to try to not interrupt too much, I'll also be sure to post both of our sponsors' information, their contact information in the chat so you can copy and paste that. But by the way, while I'm talking about her and then about Noelle, just take a picture of it with your phone as well. Just have it there in your phone as a picture that you can follow up with too, with their contact information. So again, huge thank you to Sandy. And if she does get the opportunity to jump on a little bit later, we're going to make sure to let her talk a little bit. and then Noel with AZ Residential Home Inspections. So Noel, if I will put this very simple, in a very simple manner. Noel actually just joined us at our market center in our office. You know, if you're not with our office at our Keller Williams office, you know, he just joined on as a sponsor. And it's funny because he actually came up from other agents bringing him up and saying, hey, like Noel's a really good inspector. Like you should, you know, consider having him on. And I'm laughing because I go, yeah, little do you guys know, I've actually been using him for 5 years. So you guys are making this kind of easy for me. So Noel, you know, with right off the bat, he joined the market center and also, you know, stepped up and said, I'd be more than happy to sponsor, you know, Dave Jenks, you know, which was great. And guys, you know, I always tell people, you know, it's great to hear it from other agents who have used them instead of hearing it from the vendor themselves. And much like Sandy, Noel has consistently shown up and delivered an unbelievable experience when it comes to the home inspection availability. You know, he's actually growing his team to his fourth person right now because he knows things are crazy out there and he doesn't want to make sure that, you know, that there isn't enough time on their schedule for you guys and you feel like you're being pushed off. I love how they go over the entire report in person. This is becoming a little bit better practice, but for 5 years straight, they have had the entire report ready right then at the wrap up so that when we're going over it, you know, they're not just looking at like chicken scratch notes on their notepad from having just spent 2 hours in the house. They're actually putting the entire professional report and going over the summary report with your clients. And so, you know, I know they are stepping up their game across with their technology, you know, in their field, right? To be able to see behind the walls and make sure that then they're overlooking leaks and, you know, all those important things to your clients. And I got to give credit too, because typically when you hear all these things and that kind of experience, it's also coupled with price. And I'm just talking, my clients have never once complained about the price when it comes to Noel. And so they do not only the home inspection, they can also do pool inspection, and they do their own termite inspection. And it comes with like a 90-day warranty. Like if they say, you know, termites are found after we said there weren't any, there is a 90-day warranty also coupled with that. So just a huge shout out to them. Seriously, like I said, this class is possible because of these two. So if you're needing a home inspection, you know, reach out to Noel. If you're needing help with a client and their pre-qual or have just questions, please reach out to Sandy and thank you to them. So now, Mr. Dave Jenks, how are you, sir?
I am doing good, Alex. It is wonderful to be here with you. You know, it made me think, you know, that back 23 years ago, when this little group of people came to Austin from Ahwatukee, Arizona, and we launched Market Center 99, and Scott Crouch, your OP, was there, and man, did he stir the pot, and did he set new standards, did he raise the bar. They grew from 20 agents to over 100 in 6 months. We've never seen that happen. And they really created credibility for us. And I just want to honor Scott because he was part of our original Keller Williams University faculty that we formed in 1998. He trained all over the country. He was a major influence, a great team leader. And of course, he's continued to influence the company, and he helped unlock the West for us. He was part of the group that opened up in Northern California, part of the leadership group. Anyway, I want to honor Scott. I know he's your OP and he's just a dear friend of mine. I used to stay with him and we'd play basketball out behind his house and swim in his pool and all that when I'd come out to do training. So
then you remember, remember his marketing photo with him trying to dunk the basketball. Do you remember that from a couple?
That's right. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. He was not a dunker, but he had the spirit. He played a tough game.
Well, guys, and if there's anything I can say, like as many of you know, if you're part of my office, and if you don't know, right, I've been with Keller Williams for 8 years myself, and in that journey, I actually started off at Market Center 99, you know, so I know the history there, and it's where I got to meet Scott Crouch, who he's talking about, and as our OP, you know, he's entrusted me with running this Market Center, and I can't thank him enough for that, but all in the same breath, it's because of that experience that Scott has going back to 97, you know, and being part of that with Dave and Gary and all of this, right, and growing this West Side. I've learned a lot about that, and I don't want to, you know, sometimes you feel like you can't do somebody enough justice. And I feel like that's the case with Dave, right? I know whatever the email you got and read off and, you know, co-author of The Millionaire Real Estate Agent, Millionaire Real Estate Investor, and so many other books, and, you know, his years as vice president with KW. I mean, he is, I mean, down to our, you know, our four principles, right? And everything in the MREA. And there's so much that I could say about Dave. And like I said, I want him to be able to go ahead and, you know, move forward with his why list with me. But I'm really honored to be able to have him here for our Market Center for all of you guys. And I hope you guys take really good notes and take advantage of the situation in front of you, for sure. So Dave, you should be, I'll go ahead and stop sharing my screen real quick and let you go ahead and take over. And I am here for whatever you need and whatever you guys need, but otherwise I will be very silent and let Mr. Dave do his job.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you, Alex.
You're welcome.
We'll roll for about an hour and 10 minutes and then we'll open it up for questions and ahas, but I really want to condense and focus my presentation because I'm very much cognizant of why people are here and the time they're taking out of their schedule. And I want to honor everyone who's here, because what Gary Keller and I really understood as we formed Keller Williams University back in 1996 and started building our courses and then working through our faculty like Scott and others. And that is that the greatest achievers in real estate are learning based. They take time out of their schedule to learn the business and do it better. And when they have an opportunity to hear from someone like a Dave Jenks and with my depth of experience and expertise, then they're there. Then they're there to learn from that. And so I'm not going to disappoint you. This next hour and 10 minutes is going to rock and roll.
Perfect. And then, you know what, I just saw Sandy just jump on. And do you mind if I just steal 2 minutes of your time just real quick? And we'll, that way she can do her thing as well. Is that all right with you, Dave? I'm sorry. Okay. Actually. So Sandy, I saw you jumped on. Hopefully everybody can agree. I gave you a standing ovation and a great recommendation, but I saw you're there if you had a moment.
Hey, everybody. Thanks. I appreciate that. Sorry, I had a client meeting. Lots going on in the mortgage world. We are in changing loan amounts effective January 1st. FHA has increased the loan amount. Apologize, I don't have them all memorized by heart. Conventional is 548-250. FHA changed theirs to 368. We are multiple offer time on a lot of homes. And the big thing I want to share with everybody is who you partner with matters. It matters with getting those contracts accepted with the lending partner. Fairway is Arizona's number one purchase lender. So your business is what's most important. I'm really proud to say through this whole year, 78% of our business is purchase driven. Sure, we do some refinances. We take care of the clients that we help bring them into their home. But we are here to take care of your purchase clients as well. It is time for Battle Plan 2021. And so if you're looking to really have a predictable, reproducible business for 2021, we would love to sit down with you, learn a little bit more about your business, because this is what I know. Doesn't matter what I have if it's not what you need. And so we'd love to figure out how, yes, we can take care of your mortgage clients. It's what we do. Five-star rating all the time. But also learn a little bit more about your business and see what we have that could help you get you to where you want to go in 2021. So I'll drop my stuff down in the contact, and I'm looking forward to great stuff from Dave. I've got my yellow pad of paper ready to go to notes. And have a mortgage question, just give us a call. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Andy. And guys, that right there, is the most important thing, right? When you look at your brokerage and who you choose to partner with in that department, and you look at your lenders and all of these people, right? You're looking at building your team. And that right there, guys, you know, the fact that she mentions that, and not just the mortgages, but she's looking at what she can do to help your business independently from just helping your clients. Those are the kind of things you want to hear from the people you allow in your world. So, Dave, thanks so much. I appreciate that. So we can get Sandy in there. It is all yours, sir.
Yeah, that's right. And Sandy, thank you for your comments. And thank you for being supportive of this. And thank you for the good work that you do to make our agents successful in the partnership. We deeply believe in our relationship with vendors. We operate with the best ones. We let them compete for our business. And then they build a reputation as you have, and we work with you. It's important how that works. Let me tell you what I want to do in this next time together, and really, trays, tables, and seat backs that are full upright and locked position, because we're going to rock and roll for the next hour and 10 minutes. And I want to share with you the greatest wisdom I've learned over my 30 plus years in the real estate business. And I came in, I didn't get into the world of business until they let me out of the institution of higher education. And I was in my 30s, and I was appointed as VP of sales and marketing of a large graphic arts and printing company in Albany, New York. And I had never been in business or selling, and I didn't know anything about it. But I'm like you on this call. I'm learning based. I really go after making things better. And so a friend of mine said the Dale Carnegie Institute has a sales course. And I went, well, okay, let me go take it. Well, I learned that selling operates at the highest level of human capacity and courage compared to any other one. And it's not easy to do. I had kind of looked down my nose, as an academician at salespeople, saying if you couldn't do anything else and you didn't have any credentials, you became a salesperson. And I learned differently. Selling is an incredible set of skills. And I want to focus us in on those today and share with you some of the things I learned, because they carried me through into my real estate career. And I became a training director for Century 21 in upstate New York. I became a regional director for them. They moved me to Texas to become a divisional president. And I watched this little company growing down in Austin. And I was very curious about it. And I looked at it and I said, aha, that's the future of real estate. If I were designing a real estate company, it would look like what Gary Keller's putting together, not what I was with, which was the number one company in the world at the time, Century 21, very corporate, very brand driven. But I could tell Gary was focused on his agents and he really got it. Well, it was great. So 3 years later, I got a call from Mo Anderson and she said, Gary Keller and I would like you to work with us. We think you know more about real estate franchising, and you are better at training agents than anyone we know. So I joined them and we got to write the books and of course launched the company. We only had about 2,000 agents when I got there in 96. And we've now grown to 162,000, which is amazing. But what I want to share with you is what I learned that allowed me to launch my career. And it's about the power of your words and the way you express yourself. It's so important, and that's the heart of what we're going to do today. So my first priority is to help you become a powerful listing agent, because as we say in MREA, it's leads, listings, and leverage. You list to last. Those who list do the best. Why? It gives you control of the marketplace. It gives you credibility when your sign goes up. It gives you more credibility when the sold sign goes up, and other people in that neighborhood want to talk to you or are referred to you. So number one is I want you to become an even more powerful listing agent from what you are right now. And I want you to be able to articulate your value proposition. See, that's the key. It's not just what you can do, but it's how you talk about what you can do. Is it clear? Is it compelling? Does it make people want to do business with you? Now, by the way, there are two kinds of people in the world. And this is what Gary Keller and I knew. There were growth-oriented people and stability-oriented people. And growth-oriented people say, I can get better. I can improve my skills. I can expand my knowledge. I can get better outcomes. And so I'm on a path of self-improvement. Whereas the stability person says, I am who I am. What you see is what you get. Telling it like it is. Doing the best with what I've got. And that doesn't make them a bad person. They've sort of taken the pressure off themselves. It just means they won't advance. And so those of you who are on this call are in the game of getting better at what you do. And I'm going to give you some guidelines on how to become a more powerful listing agent today. And beyond that, when you learn these sets of skills, you become a master of influence, a master of the art of influence. And that's really what allowed me to then become a leader and a regional director in the real estate business, and then a leader with Keller Williams. And because I learned how to influence people. In fact, it was funny, Alex, after I joined Keller Williams, and it was about in the early 2000s, 2002 or so, we were doing a thing called Wealth Building Wednesdays. And a friend, a lady who had been on my staff at Century 21, Christy, her name was, wrote me an email and she said, I just came back from a meeting of REMAX in Atlanta. And we spent a whole afternoon talking about how we are going to compete against Keller Williams. And she said, they put your picture up on the screen and said, this guy's the wordmeister. He's the marketing specialist. He's the guy who articulates Keller Williams. Pay attention to what he says, because we got to fight this, right? So I became a person of influence by the words I used in my way of expressing that. And I want to share some of those skills with you today, because the heart of it is building a great listing presentation. I remember one of my early mentors was Mike Ferry, and he's a real teacher of prospecting and scripts and dialogues. And I went to a big training meeting. He had over 2,000 people right there in your back ride in the Phoenix area. And at that meeting, he got up in front and he said, we really succeed in real estate with three fundamental skills: prospecting, presenting, and closing. And he said, which of those three do you think is the most important? How many think it's prospecting? And like every hand in the place went up. And he went, no, it's not. How many think it's closing? You know, that you can hang in and answer their questions and get them to sign on the dotted line. You know, maybe half the hands went up. And he went, no, it's presenting. Because he said, until you master your listing presentation, you won't prospect. You won't know your value proposition. You won't know how to articulate it. You won't know how to answer their objections. You won't prospect. And if you don't give a good listing presentation, of course, you're not going to get the listing a lot of the time. So he said, the key to this business is mastering a great listing presentation. In fact, I will tell you, to graduate from the Dale Carnegie sales course, we had to give our sales presentation in front of the whole class, each of us. And I recommend that to all of you. You ought to be able to get up in front of a team meeting in your office and give your listing presentation. Right there, right off the top, you know, and have the courage and the willingness to do that. I'm going to talk about the courage aspect of this later, right? Now, the heart of building being really good at expressing yourself are scripts and dialogues. Just remember this: scripts are the poetry of selling. Scripts are the poetry of selling. It's Gary Keller said, people have sold real estate before us. They've convinced people to list with them before us. They've convinced people to have an appointment with them before us. And they've learned how to say things in a way that's effective, and they created for us scripts. And all we have to do is incorporate and memorize those scripts and use them in our presentation because they're effective. By the way, I also want to use this analogy. You know, we all love to watch movies and shows and, you know, Netflix and all that. And what are we watching? We're just watching a bunch of scripts being delivered, right? I mean, great screenwriters know how to write words in emotionally powerful ways, and they create stories and they create scripts. And then the actors and actresses memorize those scripts. They get them down, they internalize them, and then they express them with real emotion. And we are touched by that. We watch that. We love it. Well, all they're doing is giving us scripts and dialogues. We can do the same thing. We can master the scripts and dialogues of great sales presentations. We're going to work on that today. And I want to refer to you a general word, because you really want to get in the game of expressing yourself more powerfully. And there's a wonderful book called Words That Sell by Richard Bayen. Richard Bayen. It's a great book. He has a second book called More Words That Sell. And in it, he states benefits and reasons to work with you and how to get attention by the use of words. And it's so good. It's fun to just read through that and get a rhythm of the sense of the poetry of what it is he's using to do scripts and marketing dialogues. It's wonderful. And it's a great resource to have as you put together your marketing campaigns and your advertising. Because all of this is about increasing your self-confidence. A lot of people talk about, you know, affirmations and building your self-confidence. Well, you know, you can do that a little bit, and you certainly don't want to do negative self-talk. You don't want to undermine your confidence. But here's the way you gain confidence: through competence. Competence leads to confidence. When you get good at something, your confidence goes way up, right? But you have to do the work to get good at it. to become competent. So when you become a competent listing presenter, your confidence goes way up. You can answer objections. So this whole game, because we're in a competitive game, real estate is not easy. It's a complicated, competitive game. It's a profession. As people would come up to Gary and I and say, well, you know, but it's not rocket science. And we say, oh, yes, it is. Done at a really good level, it is rocket science. It's brain surgery. This is not easy to do. And you have to build that confidence to gain your self-confidence. When you do, though, when you do, and the more you master how to say things, the more your confidence will increase. And we're going to do that because that will give you control over your career. It will not just make a good year, more listings, more sales, but it will build your career, right? And you will then start to use the language of leadership to run an MREA leadership real estate business. You can do that too. You'll find out the power of your words carries over. Now let's dive in. There's three things. There is the competence of what you do. There is the communication that you do. And then there is the way you make your presentation. We're going to do those three things. So just remember, people do business with people they like and people they respect. And why do they list with you? Well, they don't list with you for your personality. I promise you, people say this is a people, you know, agents will say, well, you know, real estate's just a people business. And we go, well, all service business is a people business. But no, real estate is a task business. It's what you do and how well you do it that builds your reputation. That's the name of this game. Everyone has to get along with people, but this is a competence game. And so we get paid for our knowledge, skills, and attitude. And I want to give you a feel for how this works. We covered this last time we were together, but there's three areas: knowledge, skills, and attitudes. And let me tell you how I would present myself to Mr. and Mrs. Seller. By the way, I'm a master of contracts, but before we get to the end of this transaction, there will be 75, 85 pages of legal documents that I will review and make sure they're filled out correctly and no mistakes and no one's trying to take advantage of you. And you can have the confidence of signing those documents because I'm a master of contracts. See, to be able to say that assertively is so powerful. A lot of agents think, you know, because they don't have the sales personality that they can't make good presentations. That's not true. If you really know contracts and finance and property evaluation, then that's what you present to somebody because that's what they're really getting from you. Same thing with finance. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I'm a master of finance. When we get our first offer, I will be able to understand whether that person is qualified to be able to fulfill the contract before we take our home off the market. Why? Because I'm a master of finance. And of course, if you're working with buyers, it matters even more, financing. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I'm a master of property evaluation. My job is to get you the highest possible price. And I can do that because I know the marketplace. I know what causes homes to sell. I know what makes them value more, worth more, because I'm a master of property evaluation. So become a master of property evaluation. Really know what makes homes more valuable, how to stage them, how to make them right, how to take care of the repairs. Know that, because that gives you power and you're going to say it. You are a master of these things that matter. Now, skills, communication, we're going to talk about being a great communicator. Presenting, this is what this is all about, presentation. And negotiating is just using the Y4C2Ts, win-win or no deal. Together, everyone achieves more. Seek first to understand. Customers always come first. All of that is all part of being a great negotiator. Now, let's talk about one of the things that Gary Keller says all the time, and that is how you think matters. Your attitude going into a venture will determine its outcome. And there's three fundamental attitudes that you want to have as a high-producing, listing-oriented agent. Number one, intention. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I'm a person of intention. I set goals and I make things happen. When I set my mind to something, I get it done. You will love working with me because I am a person of intention. So become a person of intention. Have your goals, have your 1-3-5, have your 4-1-1s. Allow yourself to be held accountable. Know that when you set your mind to something, you get it done. Then you can present that to them. I'm a person who gets things done, right? Become that. Now, second of all, assertiveness. I'll tell you, this one is an important one. I believe everyone in business, everyone in real estate can be more assertive, not more aggressive. This isn't about controlling people or hurting them. It's about standing up and speaking your mind fully and boldly, doing things that other people don't have the courage to do, asking for what you want and expecting it. Assertive behavior is important. I will tell you, this unlocked the difference for me being just kind of a laid back, good old boy trainer that people liked, to being a leader that got to be a regional director of Century 21, a divisional president, and then of course a leader in Keller Williams. It was that I realized I needed to increase my assertive behavior, that I was playing it too laid back. I cared too much about what other people thought. I wasn't speaking my mind. I wasn't speaking boldly. I wasn't taking charge of things like a leader does. So I found a thing called the Assertiveness Bill of Rights. It's a wonderful statement. I'll tell you how to get a copy of it later. The Assertiveness Bill of Rights, and I followed that and I became more assertive. In fact, I'll tell you an interesting story. So I was a training director, and the guy who was the regional director left to be appointed to a big executive position in Century 21 in California. And then I wanted to, and I applied 2 years later to become regional director of that upstate New York, that three-state region. And I went to an interview with him, and I could tell as we were going in the interview that he was trying to find a way to let me down, to say, Dave, we've got so many candidates and you're really good and we respect you, but we're gonna pick somebody else. I could just feel that coming. And I said, Marv, I'll stop you right now. That the man you left in New York is not the same 2 years ago, is not the same man sitting in front of you today. I am a leader. I am meant to take this position and I will get things done for you. And I got hired. I got hired. But I would have never expressed myself or said that any time before that, because I learned to be assertive. So I want to challenge all of you to learn to be more assertive, not more aggressive. And then you can say, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, one of the things you will find about working with me is I'm an assertive person. I'm not aggressive. I get along really well with people. People like working with me, but I stand up and speak out. I will make sure no one takes advantage of you. I will assert what we want in your transaction. I will get you what you want because I am an assertive person. See, that's what you want to be able to say. Then the final one is you're a person of commitment. You make commitments and you deliver on them. Tom Caldwell, one of our real early pioneers in Keller Williams, took Keller Williams up into Remax's backyard in Colorado and just made it successful. Really, really a wonderful man in our pioneer. And he said, Dave, the secret of success is doing what you say you'll do. Wow, just as simple as that. Dave, the secret of success is doing what you say you'll do. Promises made, promises kept. And I thought, wow, that's so good. And I think that's one of the things to become a person who really does what they say. And I would say that, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, what you like about working with me is I'm a person of commitment. If I say I'm going to do something, you can take it to the bank. Promises made, promises kept. I will always deliver on what I say I will. I am a person of commitment. See, if you can talk about yourself in that kind of assertive, strong way, people want to work with you. So I want to help you build your confidence to speak that strongly, that assertively about who you are. Okay, now, so there we go. Attitude, skills, and knowledge. People do business with people they like. That we're building our competence at this really tough game of real estate. It's tough, it's competitive, it's complicated, it's not easy to do. You're building it. You are expanding your skills. Now, the second part is communication. And the fundamentals of that are in Dale Carnegie's book, How to Win Friends and Influence People. I mean, every year it's in the top 200 of Amazon.com, that book, How to Win Friends and Influence People. And it was written 75 years ago. Astounding. Why? Because it's full of timeless truth that can be applied today, just like MREA. Why is MREA, after 17 years, still the number one selling book in real estate on Amazon.com? Today, obviously, it's the best-selling book of all time, but even today, it sells more. Why? Because it's full of timeless truths. We wrote it with timeless truths in it. So always pay attention to the timeless truths. And here's what Dale Carnegie says about how you work effectively with people. He said, first, there's the big three. Don't criticize, condemn, and complain. He said, the minute you put your mind into criticizing, condemning, or complaining, you go to a negative space and you don't want to go there yourself. And you certainly don't want to do that in front of other people or with other people. The key to relationships is not to criticize, condemn, and complain. My wife and I work on this all the time in our relationship, to not criticize, condemn, or complain about others, and certainly not about ourselves. So get rid of the three C's and keep yourself in a positive energy state. The second one is give honest, sincere appreciation. Probably the most powerful script in the world is thank you. I appreciate that. I am honored that you are doing that. Thank you. You know, so I think that that gives honest, sincere appreciation. One of the best agents I knew, Jim Droz, was one of the most gentlemanly, easygoing person. He, you know, his script, when he would knock on doors trying to get to know people in his farm area, he'd knock on the door and he'd say, Mr. and Mrs. Homeowner, hi, I'm Jim Droz with Century 21, and I'm really sorry to bother you here at home. I know it's your quiet and private place, but there's really one question I want to ask you. May I? Sure, Jim, what? It's my commitment to make this neighborhood a better place to live. What one thing could I do or cause to be done that would make this a better place to live? That's all he asked. Some would invite him in, some would give him an idea. Some would say, can't think of one, Jim, and then he would be in touch with them. But within that 6 months of doing that every day, he took 37 listings, and that launched his career, and he became the number one real estate agent in all of Century 21, the largest real estate company in the world at the time. Because he always gave honest, sincere appreciation. He'd say, thank you for inviting me into your home and letting me earn the right to list your home. It was always sincere appreciation. So give honest, sincere appreciation everywhere you can. And then finally, focus on what others want. Zig Ziglar said, you will have what you want in direct proportion to the number of people who you help get what they want. See, it's called the platinum rule. Help others get what they want. Then you can earn what you want. It's the nature of the game. Just make sure you do that. So don't criticize, condemn, and complain. Give honest, sincere appreciation all the time. Look for people you can appreciate and focus on what other people want and helping them get that. Now, here are the supportive six. He said, be genuinely interested in other people. Let curiosity drive you. Gary Gentry, the agent who did the first closed transaction in the history of Keller Williams back in 1983, wonderful guy. He and his wife, Melody, still run a great team down in Austin. He said, Dave, I get to know more about people in a half an hour than anyone else I know because I have this immense curiosity. I ask them great questions. I listen carefully. They can tell. They trust me. They open up to me. I probe. I want to really know them. So become genuinely interested in other people, more interested in them than expressing who you are, right? Get to know them. And the second thing is smile. Let that natural energy. I know with masks and all that stuff, we're getting rid of, we're kind of shutting down our nonverbal behavior, but let your energy come through. Be positive. People like to work with positive people, and a smile really shows your positivity. And then third, remember people's name. It's the most pleasant sound to anyone's ear is their name. And do not say to me, Dave, I'm not good at remembering names. Oh, Dave, I've always been terrible at remembering names. Don't give yourself that self-talk. That is talking yourself out of a skill you can have. Everyone struggles with remembering people's names. You know why? It's in a different part of the brain. In other words, your ability to connect with people, neuroscience has proven this, your ability to connect with people is a right brain function. You know who they are, you have a closeness to them, you may know their history, but all the labels are over here, who they work with, where they're from, where they went to school, their kids' names, their pets' names, that's on the left side of your brain. And you need to work to bring those together. And that takes repetition. It takes attention and repetition. Everyone struggles with this. So the thing to remember is always write their name down. And if you didn't do that and you forget it, say, I'm sorry, little mind glitch, remind me, your name is, yeah, well, thank you, Mary. Make sure you get it right, spell it right. If it's Elizabeth, do you like Elizabeth or Beth or Liz? What do you, you know, Dave or David, get that right. And then use it. Here's repetition is the mother of mastery. So Dave, thank you for inviting me in here and letting me for the chance to earn the right to handle the sale of your home. Dave, let me tell you what I want to do in the next few minutes. I'm going to ask you a series of questions, Dave, so I can get a clear understanding of how I can help you achieve those. Does that sound okay, Dave? See, and you might say, well, it sounds like you're using his name way too much. And the point is, a person will never feel that way. Use their name a lot, and it will then lock it into your memory. The next one is encourage them to talk about themselves. Don't talk. This is not a time for you to talk about yourself. There is a time. We'll get to that in a second where you present yourself. But right now, building rapport and making connection, it's getting them to talk about themselves and talk about their interests, not yours. One of the mistakes people make is to think, if I have common interests with them, we will be bonded. And that's not always true, right? Like if I say, so what do you like recreationally? Oh, I kind of like to play golf. Oh, you like to play golf? I love to play golf. I'm addicted to golf. I'm a 5.2 handicap. What's yours? Are you a member of a country club? I'm a member of Oak Hill. Yeah, yeah. What courses have you played that you really liked? I got to play Pebble Beach. Isn't that amazing? See, and all, you can feel it. All of a sudden, you're doing a one-upmanship, almost a competition with them, and that doesn't feel good to them. No, find out about them. If you have a common interest with them, say you love movies, and somebody says, my wife and I like to go to watch movies. Oh, you do? That's great. What kind of movies do you like the best? Yeah. Are there any actors or actresses that you particularly like to see? Yeah. What about directors? Are there movies by any directors that you particularly favor? So let me ask you this. In the last couple of weeks, what movies have you seen that you would recommend for me? Yeah. Okay, great. See, I'm using my interest in and awareness of movies to ask them about them, not to express myself about them. So no me toos. Avoid the me toos. This is about them, not you. And then finally, make others feel important. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I'm here to apply for the job of handling the sale of your home. You're the boss, and I need to meet your standards. By the way, all the way through this, I will give you great recommendations and all the information you need, but you will be the one that makes decisions, and I will implement those decisions because you're the boss. See, put them in that position. And of course, if they have a career position of authority, honor them for that, or thank you for your service if they were in the military. Honor them for anything they do that you can genuinely make them feel important about. So those are the supportive six, right? Genuinely be interested in others. Let your curiosity drive you. Smile, be positive, let that energy come through. Encourage others to talk about themselves, talk about their interests, not yours, no me toos, right? And make other people feel important. So there we have competence and communication. And now we get down to the presentation, and it all revolves around our use of language, scripts, and dialogues. Remember, scripts are the poetry of selling. Scripts are the poetry of influencing. And there's a four-step process that Gary and I developed and taught: memorize, internalize, customize, and capitalize. In other words, first you memorize it exactly as it's written, exactly as the script is, because just like with screenwriters, these scripts are written with a rhythm and a use of words and a power. They are poetry. And you don't want to mess up that poetry and dumb it down by making it your own words. So you memorize it exactly as is. Then you internalize it, meaning you get the feel of it. The more you memorize a script, the more you can feel its rhythm and its power and its emotionality. And then when you express it, it comes out, right? So it'll be your personality, but it will be those words and those emotions. And then you customize it, meaning you don't use your same scripts all the time. You use ones that fit. Like, here's a great short script, right? Handle the sale of your home. See, I think that's the most powerful way to say what you do. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I'm here to apply for the job of handling the sale of your home. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, when I handle the sale of your home, not list it, market it, sell it, those are dumb words. Those are mediocre words. No, it's fiduciary. I handle the sale of your home. So learn to use bits and pieces, just like thank you, and customize that script to fit in. And of course, capitalize is once you do this, then you get that mastery. But you have to work at this. You know, there's in our day and age of having Google and smartphones and GPSs, we've kind of lost this ability to memorize things. And so it's a memory. It's something you want to work on. Memorize quotes, memorize things that you want to share, memorize poems. I love poems. As we came into this COVID time, I was reminded of Rudyard Kipling's great poem, If you can keep your head while all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you. If you can trust yourself while others doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too. If you can wait and not be tired by waiting or being lied about, not dealing lies, or being hated, not give way to hating, and yet not act too good or talk too wise. If you can dream and not make dreams your master. If you can think and not make thought your aim. If you can meet with triumph and disaster and treat those two imposters just the same. And it goes on for a couple more verses, and then it ends with, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, then yours is the world and anything that's in it. And more than that, life's battle you'll have won. I love that poem. But here's the thing for me, it's fun to memorize that, right? It's fun to pick things and memorize them and do memorizing exercises. And of course, memorize your scripts and dialogues and commit yourself to practicing them. Right? Now, let's dive into the listing presentation. This is so important. There's several aspects. This is after you've built rapport and gone around the house and talked with them about their interests and that. Now we're down to the crux of why list with me. One, you want to set the stage. Two, you want to make an effective, tight, concise presentation that highlights the key benefits they're going to get because they list with you, that then focuses on the big issues in selling of pricing and staging. And then, of course, if you need to, explain your commission. So we'll deal with subscripts and dialogues for all of this. Here's the first one. It's called the 1 minute listing presentation. I learned it from Mike Ferry. It goes like this. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I've written down three very important questions. May I ask them? First, do you absolutely have to sell your home? Oh yeah, Dave, we've got to be out of here in like 6 or 8 weeks. So we got to sell it. Okay, great. Are you willing to price it to sell? Well, we'll do whatever you say. We'll price it, yeah, to get it sold for sure, for sure. Okay, and would you like me to handle the sale for you? Oh yeah, you come so highly recommended, Dave. Yeah, we want to list with you for sure. Great, let's get started. See, I got three yeses. I don't need any listing presentation. I have three yeses. I've got the listing. Now let's get to work. Let's do the paperwork. Let's price it right. Let's get, you know, decide when we want to put it on the market. Let's get the staging done right. Let's get all of that. Let's get to work because I have the listing. In 1 minute, I got the listing. I don't need to go on and talk about my credentials and all the sales I've done and what people say about me and all that stuff that we clutter it up with. The 1 minute listing presentation. Well, Dave, yeah, but you're not always going to get three yeses. Of course you're not. So here's how it goes. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I've written down three very important questions. May I ask them? First, do you absolutely have to sell your home? Well, no, not really. We really love living here. This is great. We just thought we'd put it on the market, see what it might get. Wonderful, good. Are you willing to price it to sell? Well, we need to get at least $700,000 for it. We used to get at least $700,000 for it. Yep, okay, good. And would you like me to handle the sale for you? Well, we're talking to you, but we're going to interview two other agents too. Okay, great. Let's get started. See, notice I haven't bought into anything they've said. What I've taken though is I've taken in information. The first question, do you absolutely have to sell your home, is about motivation. See, and the way they answered that, they don't sound motivated. I may not take the listing. They don't sound like they really want to sell. I don't want to do all that work just to see what kind of price they can get. Number two is, are you willing to price it? Say that they said $700,000 and I know you can't get $580 or $590 for it, then I've got some education work to do. So the first one is motivation. The answer to the second one is education. I have to educate them on how the market is and how it works. And the third one is commitment. And I don't have a commitment from them if they're interviewing two more agents. And so I need to be so good in my presentation that they say, Dave, yes, please handle the listing for me. And I go, great, I'll call those other two agents, tell them they can bring their qualified buyers to your home, but we've got the listing taken care of. Okay, great, be happy to do that. See, that's it. Now, understand, the answers don't matter except they tell you where that person is, and you're either gonna dive in and start doing the work if you get three yeses, but if you get others, then you know you have to do your presentation and get to work. The But just memorize these three. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I've written down three very important questions. See, it has that sense of immediacy. I have written down three very important questions. You don't say, hey, I have three questions that I've memorized and I want to ask, you know, obviously, but you make it more immediate. I've written down three very important questions. May I ask them? Do you absolutely have to sell your home? Two, are you willing to price it to sell? And three, would you like me to handle the sale for you? Notice shaking your head positively. So 1 minute listing presentation. Here's another thing. We want to get their attention because their mind may be wandering. They don't know how long this is going to take. You know, they may be thinking about something at work or the shopping list or homeschooling or whatever. And so you want to get them focused on what's happening right now. And so here's what you do. It's called the three outcomes. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, at the end of our meeting, one of three things will happen. One, you will decide to have me handle the sale for you. Or two, you will decide not to list with me. Or three, I will decide not to take your listing. Any of those three is okay with me. Does that make sense? Whoa. Now they know they better pay attention because there's going to be a decision made. And one of them may be that you don't take their listing. This is powerful because you don't want to be there in a state of neediness. Oh, I need this listing or wanting it too much. You don't want to do that. You want to let them know that you're okay with any of these. If they even say no to you, you're okay with that, right? I mean, this isn't bothering you. You're confident, right? So Mr. and Mrs. Seller, and by the way, this is the other thing is you want to put a time frame on this because people take way too much time. If you're going to be a big listing agent, you're going to take it in half an hour to 45 minutes. Yeah, okay, you have some rapport work before and maybe some measuring and photos work after. But the point is the listing presentation, half an hour, 30 minutes. So you say, you put that on the table, setting the stage. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, at the end of our meeting, which will only take about 30 minutes, 45 minutes at the longest, one of three things will happen. You will decide to have me handle the sale of your home, or two, you will decide not to list with me, or three, I will decide not to take your listing. And I just want you to know any of those three is okay with me. Does that make sense? All right, let's get started. Perfect. Now, another thing in setting the stage is something I learned from Floyd Whitman called the safe island, because people don't know where this is going to go. And you want to come across as organized and efficient. And also that they can be ready to know that there's an organized step you're going to go through and it's not going to take too long, right? And that's called the safe island. And also in this is a memory exercise called stacking. And a stack is where you stack up objects on top of one another to key you in to memorize what it is you're going to say so you don't need to refer to notes. So for example, if you're giving a speech or you're teaching a class, then you would take the elements of that class and you would stack them. Like if I'm teaching a class on mastering scripts and dialogues, I have everyone standing in there, 20, 30 people, no one sitting at desks, no chairs, no notes, no notepads, no technology. I don't have any notepads, no technology, no PowerPoint. I'm in front of them. And for 3 hours with a couple of breaks, we just memorize scripts. I demonstrate them, we do it together. Then they role play, then we do it together again. Then we go to the next script and we work our way back and forth. And at the end of 3 hours, we've mastered 18, 19, 20 scripts. Well, how do I do that? Well, I stack those scripts with different objects in a stack. And then I just, in my mind, follow that stack. So let me just show you how it works in a simplified way here. So at the bottom of the stack is the letter B followed by the number 4 in bright pink, B4, right? On top of that is a stopwatch. It only has 1 minute. And we think 1 minute. Out of the stopwatch are 4 steps and they're numbered 1, 2, 3, 4. On the top step is a set of question marks all gobbled together, right? On top of the question marks is a shopping cart, what we're going to call a market basket full of numbers. On top of the market basket is a jail cell, a window with bars on it and a prisoner behind it. And we think jail cell. On top of that, coming out of it is a spiral staircase, and we think of steps, right? So what's on the bottom? Before, then 1 minute, then 4 steps, then question marks, then market basket, then jail cell, then steps. All right, so this is how it would go. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, before we begin, may I take a minute to tell you how I work? Basically, I use 4 steps. First, I'm going to ask you a series of questions so I can get a clear idea of what you want to accomplish and how I can help. Then I'm going to give you enough market information for you to make a rational decision about the price to place on your property. And then I'm going to honestly sell you on the benefits of working with me and my company and how we get the results we do. And finally, when you hire me to handle the sale of your home, I will tell you step by step all the things I will do to cause your home to sell. How's that sound? You ready to get started? All right, let's go. So by the way, the safe island, there you go. Now, here's the key of selling. I learned this in the Dale Carnegie course. I just want to put it to you. The whole key in being a person of influence is anytime you're talking with someone about what you do or what they need to do, it's facts, benefits, and feelings. Remember that flow, facts, benefits, feelings. Facts, benefits, feelings. Facts is what I do, benefits is what you get, feelings is how you will feel afterwards, right? Facts, what I do, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, here's what I do. And you will therefore be able to get this, and this will make you feel blank. Like I said earlier, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, by the time we get to the end of this transaction, there will be 75 to 85 pages of legal documents that I will review in detail so that you are confident in being able to know that you're not being taken advantage of, there are no mistakes, and you can sign those with peace of mind and a feeling of security. That makes sense? Mr. and Mrs. Seller, by the way, you can ask me a question anytime, but I will be reporting to you consistently on a weekly scheduled basis exactly where things are in the transaction, which means that you will know the progress we're making, how we're going, and that we're moving toward the successful sale of your home. And that will give you that kind of confidence and security and knowing that you're listened to and you can ask your questions, right? Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I'm going to give you enough market information, because I'm a student of the market, so that you can make the good decision on the price to place on your property so that we can get the highest possible price for your home and you can have that feeling of satisfaction and happiness that you got the most money possible from your home. See, facts, benefits, feelings, facts, benefits, feelings. Master that flow. That's the flow of influence. Anytime you're trying to influence somebody or sell them, tell them what you want them to do or what you're going to do, the benefit that they will receive from that and how that will make them feel. And really focus on this feeling end, because a lot of people sort of ignore that. So focus on peace of mind and relaxation and people being respected and listened to and getting a sense of confidence and security and having satisfaction and well-being and a feeling of happiness and joy, you know, of moving on to the next part of their life. Facts, benefits, feelings, the heart of effective selling right there. Now, pay close attention. I'm going to flip the screen and I'm going to tell you this is the heart of the listing presentation I would make right here. Don't make it complicated. It's this straightforward. Here it is. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, there's really three reasons to list your home with me. One, you can trust me. Two, I will answer all your questions. And three, I will protect you all the way through closing. How does that sound? Are we ready to get started? Good, let's get after it. You see that? You don't have to say more. You don't have to give them all your credentials and how many sales you've done and all that stuff and testimonials. You don't have to, because what they care about are three things: that they can trust you, that you will take them seriously and answer their questions, and that you will handle all the details and protect them. They want to be taken care of, protected all the way through closing. That's all they want to know. And you're saying it. You're assertive. This is where you get assertive, right? Mr. and Mrs. Seller, there's really three reasons to list your home with me. One, you can trust me. Two, I will answer all your questions. And three, I will protect you all the way through closing. Now, you could expand it if you want to, Mr. and Mrs. Seller. There's really three reasons to list with me. Number one is you can trust me. Other people say that they would trust their children and their bank accounts with me. I am a person that is trustworthy. You can trust me. And number two is you can ask me questions anytime, and I will always listen carefully and I will answer them. And I'm a professional, so I know what I know and I know what I don't. If I know the answer, you'll get it. If I don't know the answer, I've got this incredible company, Keller Williams, behind me, and I will get you the right answer. And three, I will protect you all the way through closing. I will review all the documents. I'll make sure no one's taking advantage of you. I'll make sure there's no mistakes. I'll get any problems handled, because I will protect your interests and take care of you all the way through closing. See, so you can expand it if you think you need to, but I don't think you need to. I think, say, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, here's the heart of the matter. There are really three reasons to have me handle the sale of your home. One, you can trust me. Two, I will answer all your questions. And three, I will protect you all the way through closing. Don't complicate it. Keep it simple. Now, some people may want more details. So there's two magical pages in MREA. Page 95 is a listing presentation on one page, the 10 things you do for a seller. You could make a photocopy of that, blow it up, take it in, and read right there, just as it's written, the 10 things you do to serve a seller and get their home sold successfully. And that would be better than 95% of any listing presentations they've ever heard. Why? Because it's real and it's detailed. It's right there already, page 95. And then on page 151 are the 14 ways that you cause a home to sell, the way you market it, right? Those are right there. And that's the heart of a presentation in terms of details. So you could say, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, by the way, there's 10 fundamental things I do to serve you and get your home sold. How much detail would you like me to share with you? Oh, Dave, don't bother with the detail. You'll tell us as we go along. Let's just get started in the process. See, a lot of people would just say that, but others would say, oh yeah, no, Dave, tell us, what are the things you do? Well, really, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, there's really 10 things I do to successfully sell your home. Number one is I'm gonna ask you a series of questions, do a thorough needs analysis so I know your priorities and plans of what you want and how I can get that done for you. Number two is I'm gonna give you enough market information to make an intelligent pricing strategy so we get the most money possible for your home. Number three is I'm gonna be a professional recommendation to you on repairs we may wanna do ahead of time to make the home more attractive and not have there be any question, and also to stage it so it competes effectively against the other properties that are out there. And number four is I will sit down with you. I have a 14-step marketing plan and we'll decide which ones are appropriate for your property and we'll get clear on that. And then number five, my job really begins when we get our first offer and I will evaluate it and see if it's honest and credible. If there's multiple offers, I'll deal with those. And by the way, number six, I will negotiate finally on your behalf to make sure the final contract of sale meets your needs, meets our terms, and exactly what we want. I'll do that, right? And number seven, because there will be maybe some things required of us in terms of repairs, I have vendors that'll do that. I will get prices for us and I will coordinate any repairs that are needed to fulfill the contract. And then, as I said, there's 75 or 85 pages of legal documents. I will review all those ahead of closing and make sure they're accurate. No one's taking advantage of you. And you can feel confident in signing those. And then I'll be there with you at closing in case there's any last minute questions or things that need to be resolved. And finally, after it closes, I still want to be your realtor. I want to be your realtor for life. And so I will help you with your move. In fact, do you have an agent where you're moving? Do you have one that's helping you buy a home over there? Because I can get you a great agent there. And then they can coordinate. I can coordinate with them about your purchase and the sale here. It really works out well. Would you like me to do that? Great, I'd be happy to. And of course, the sale of your home creates a tax event. So I will give you all of the proper paperwork you need to take to your CPA or your tax prep person to include the sale of your home in your tax filing. Does that sound good? Good. Any questions about any of that? See, there you go. There it is. Practice this list. Now, A couple of specialized scripts. I want to get us clear on this. So one of the things is to take ourselves to a higher level than any other agent, right? And we call that fiduciary, being a fiduciary agent. Gary Keller says it's really the advantage of every client to have a fiduciary agent, one who takes care of their interests. But people aren't used to the word fiduciary. So here's how you would say it to them. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I am licensed by the state of Arizona to represent you in the sale of your home. And I will always place your interest above the interest of any other party, including my own. And I am committed to get you the highest price in the shortest time with a minimum of inconvenience to you. Does that sound good? Yeah, it does. Now, no other agent will talk about themselves with that kind of strength, right? And you're this higher authority of the state of Arizona to represent you, not to represent any sellers and buyers and all that. No, to represent them in the sale of their home. And what does that mean? Placing their interest above others. So just memorize this script. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, I just want to remind you, I'm licensed by the state of Arizona to represent you in the sale of your home. And I will therefore always place your interests above the interests of any other party, including my own. And my commitment is to get you the highest price in the shortest time with a minimum of inconvenience to you. Does that sound right? Yeah, good. Now, Linda McKissick said, she said, the way I launched my career, I had to learn how to state the obvious with emotional power. She said, I used to be a country girl that just told it like it was, kind of ho-hum, this is just what it is. And she said, I realized I was boring. And if I was going to be a great salesperson, I needed to master my scripts and dialogues. And so I did. I started to learn how to talk in more effective and convincing and influential ways. And I said, well, what do you mean? Give me an example. We should, for example, she said, here's one of my favorite ones. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, when you hire me to handle the sale of your home, I will immediately tomorrow morning notify all the other realtors in the area, one, that your home is on the market, two, its best features, and three, why they should bring their qualified buyers to see it. Would you like me to do that? Oh yeah, Linda, that'd be great. Please do all those things. See, a mediocre agent's gonna say, yeah, we'll put it in the MLS and we'll put a sign in the yard. You know, come on. Say it with some power. This is what the MLS does. It's a great function and you're making it happen. Take credit for it. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, when you hire me to handle the sale of your home, I will immediately, sense of urgency, tomorrow morning notify all the other realtors, right? This is like busy in the area, and three things, power comes in three. And that is one, your home is on the market, its best features, and why they should bring their qualified buyers to see it. Now, another thing is about advertising. I learned this one from Althea Osborne. You know, Althea, who was a great agent in Keller Williams, originally was part of rebuilding Keller Williams with the profit share and open books and ALCs and all that stuff. And she worked with the tech industries, and she had a lot of people that got into very expensive homes. And she said, they would say to me, Althea, where are you going to advertise our home? And she would say, well, Jim, let me educate you about how real estate really works. Ads don't sell homes, realtors do. And I'm already investing half of my commission as an incentive for the best agents to bring their qualified buyers to your home. And as your agent, I will never waste your money. And I certainly wouldn't waste my own. Isn't that powerful? It's powerful. And it's true. See, other people say, well, it's just co-broking. Well, yeah. It is co-broking, but I remember when I got in the business, there were brokers that didn't co-broke. You had to get that listing, you had to go through them. But the real estate industry has matured and almost everybody does co-broking, but take credit for it. See, take credit for it, that you are giving away part of your commission so that their home will sell, which is the way it is. And that's more important than any advertising expense, which doesn't sell homes. It may attract more people for business, but it doesn't sell homes. So this is truth, by the way, but Althea says it in such a powerful way. She says, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, let me educate you. See, that's assertive. Let me educate you about how real estate really works. Ads don't sell homes, realtors do. And I'm already investing half of my commission as an incentive for the best agent to bring their qualified buyers. Understand, see that positive words? The best agents to bring their qualified buyers to your home. Right? Those extra special words, best agents, qualified buyers, they mean a lot. That's why this is poetry, right? As an incentive for the best agents to bring their qualified buyers to your home. And then the kicker is this, as your agent, I will never waste your money. And I certainly wouldn't waste my own. So whether you think this commission is your money or my money, we're not going to waste it. See, so powerful. It's magical. Now, in the old days, when we first came out here to Arizona, you know, it was like, well, I'd love to list with you, but I've never heard of this company you're with. What is it, Keller what? Oh yeah, Keller Williams. Well, let me tell you about Keller Williams. Keller Williams is the newest, most innovative, fastest growing real estate company in America and right here in Arizona. Really? Yeah, I didn't know that. Yeah. That's why I'm with Keller Williams. See, it's powerful. But now where it's a different game, here we are, you know, 20 years later and it's a different game. Mr. and Mrs. Seller, let me tell you about Keller Williams. Keller Williams is the largest, most innovative, and highly respected real estate company in the world. And then here's the kicker. Magic comes in threes. And I'm with Keller Williams because at Keller Williams, I'm a partner in the business. I get to share in the profits. I have a say in all the decisions. And more important than that, I am empowered to do whatever it takes to best serve you. Isn't that powerful? And by the way, it's all true, right? You are a partner in Keller Williams. That's how we treat our agents. And you can share in the profits if you earn the right. You can have a say in all the decisions through the ALC, and you always have a role in that. And of course, within Keller Williams, the agent is free to within law and ethics, to do whatever they need to do to serve their client. They don't have to check back with management, right? So this is an important one, right? And I'm with Keller Williams because at Keller Williams, I'm a partner in the business. Yeah, I can share in the profits. I have a say in all the decisions. And more important than that, I am empowered to do whatever it takes to best serve you. Love this company, right? We say that. Now, pricing. The thing is, never get in an argument about pricing. You are always on their side of the table. They say, well, I want to get 700, and you know you can only get 580, 590. You say, all right, let's get really clear on this, Mr. and Mrs. Seller. I'm on your side. We are going to get the most money possible for your home. I promise you that. That is my commitment to you. Now, what we both need to deal with is the reality of the marketplace that's out there and what current buyers are willing to pay for your home. And remember this, there's really two markets out there. There are homes that are on the market, they're overpriced, and they don't look very good, and they're not getting many showings and no offers. Then there's homes that are in the market and they're priced right and they look good and they're getting offers and sometimes multiple offers. Now, my job is not to list your home and just put it on the market. No, no, no. My job is to make sure we are in the market because we want to take advantage of this window of opportunity. See, when a new listing comes on, we've got about 10 days to 2 weeks to get the highest possible price. Because the whole market, all the agents and all the current buyers will pay attention to our home when it first comes on the market. And we better make a good first impression. If we make a bad first impression, if we're overpriced or we don't look very good or we need repairs, we'll lose their interest and it's hard to get it back. So we will hit it right. And then they will come to us and we will get our best offer, highest possible, in the first 10 days to 2 weeks. That's what I know. Now, there's a danger in chasing the market. If the market's going up, I price ahead of it. If the market's coming down, I price ahead of it. The point is, we don't want to be chasing the market. And the research says that if you price it right, you will get your highest possible price. And that's my commitment to you. We're going to get that highest possible price. See, you've put out there all of the conditions. By the way, all this stuff comes out of chapter seven and chapter eight of the book Shift. Right, and it's all about pricing it right and staging it right, and all of this language and words are there. So be there. And then, of course, they might say, Dave, would you cut your commission? Would you do it for less? And I go, oh man, I understand really that you want to get the best deal possible. I'm a shopper too, like you are. And you know, there's days I love helping people sell their homes. There's days I think I would do it for free, but I don't think my family would like that. Let me tell you what happens with commissions. Many people don't understand what really happens to the commission. So let me explain. First of all, half of it, 3%, goes to the company or agent that brings us a qualified buyer. So in a sense, it's not a commission, it's a marketing fee. That's how we get your home sold. Of the remaining 3%, 1/3 of it goes to my company, Keller Williams, greatest company in the world, but I have to pay to be part of them and take advantage of all the things they bring to the sale of your home. And another third of it covers my business expenses. In other words, my staffing and my automation and technology and marketing. So that only leaves 1% for me and my family. And I know you would understand that I really, in good faith, can't count that. Okay. A lot of people think that that whole 6% or whatever it is, 5.5%, 6% goes to you. And they need to understand it doesn't. There's a small portion of it that ends up with you. Now, I have an agent in San Antonio that says, Mr. and Mrs. Seller, by the way, before we begin, I want you to understand one thing. I charge 1% more than the average agent in the area. They're averaging about 6, I charge 7. Because I know I'm worth it. I know I will get you more. I will get you more money and less hassle. And you can trust me more, but I do charge more. Is that okay? Sure, Mary, that's fine. See? But don't ever apologize for what you charge. Do not ever. The industry has worked out a really great way to cause homes to sell and get sellers the highest possible price. That's what we do. That's what our industry does. That's what you as an agent do. Never apologize for the commission you charge. It's a good deal. And even though others will do it for less, your answer to that is yeah, and they'll probably take less for your property. Understand that I will get you the most money and I will earn my commission for sure, right? You put it there. So the final thing I wanna hit, and then we'll open it up for questions or any other ahas that you have. And I just wanna say to you, by the way, if you want a copy of this plus a thing, Dave's favorite scripts, which include a lot of scripts that weren't included in this presentation. So I'll send you a copy of all this presentation, all these scripts, plus my favorite scripts, which are a bunch more, particularly in terms of lead generation. And I will give you the Assertiveness Bill of Rights, that whole page of the Assertiveness Bill of Rights. I think you'll enjoy that about being more assertive. And then finally, the Rudyard Kipling poem, If, a copy of that. So you get all four of those things, but here's the way you earn it. You write me, dave@kw.com, dave@kw.com. And just tell me three ahas that you got from this presentation, any three. What three, you can make any comments you want, but what three ahas did you get from this presentation? Send me that in an email, dave@kw.com, and I will send you within a day, I'll send you all four of those items, okay? Here's the final thing I wanna talk with you about, the most important sales presentation you will ever make, and that is the one to yourself. See, there's incredible power of self-talk. There's a wonderful book called Feeling Good, by Dr. David Burns, and it's all about the way we talk to ourselves, the 10 ways that we dysfunctionally talk to ourselves and undermine our confidence and create anxiety and depression. It's a wonderful book on how to deal with your own mental attitude. And in there, he says, your self-talk is the most important conversation you'll have. And I agree with that. And I want you to power up your self-talk and say things like this. I am in a skill-based sales profession that not everybody can do. Only about 20% of people survive, only about 10% do decently, and only about 5% really thrive, and I'm going to be one of those. And I'm mastering the skills of this profession because it's a very demanding skill-based and knowledge-based business. And I practice hard, long, and often to do this. I'm like a professional athlete. I put a lot of time in my practice because I want to be competent, and that will therefore lead to my increased confidence. And that confidence will come through and people will feel that from me. They'll feel my assertiveness. They'll want to work with me. Then my signs will go up and that gives me credibility. And when a sold sign goes up, that gives me more credibility. And I start to get referrals and people calling me wanting to list with me. I take more listings, and then I will do ultimately what Gary and Dave and Jay said in the book, and that is, I will in my career think big, I will aim high, and I will act bold. There we go, sir. Alex,
awesome, man.
Why list with me?
I didn't want to interrupt you. There were so many points I wanted to jump in and say yes.
I know. Alex, you're a jumper-inner. And you know what I realize? I realize that I'm working with a lot of people that are very assertive, right? And they want an interaction, which I'd love. If we had 3 hours and it was a more of a mastermind, I would love that. But what I realize in this time frame I have to give the best that I have in about an hour and 10 minutes, right? And then allow people through the discussion we can do now or getting the materials that I'm going to send out, the follow through. Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, what I wanted to say is you better have a good minimum of 10 emails from people because I was getting those messages and text messages in the background of like, hey, do you think we can get
I would, you know, my wife, sometimes my wife tunes in on these and she goes, Dave, you should see what's going on in the chat. I said, I can't pay attention to the chat.
So they were direct to me or they were literally texting my cell phone and they were all like, can I get these? So everybody that asked, I do expect you get a good handful of emails. Good.
And the thing is, I would say to people, you know, I could send them to Alex to send out, but I'm not going to do that because that's welfare, right? What I want you to do is earn it. And the way you earn it is you send me the email and tell me the three things you got. And that's more important. Gary Keller says, ahas are the most important form of learning. Questions are important, but when you get an aha, now you see a question says, I need to know more before I do something, but an aha says, I got it. I'm going to go do it. So ahas are, that's why I ask for ahas. So make sure you send them in. Yeah. But if you have a question now, either chat it in to Alex, that'd be fine. If anyone has a question that they'd like to ask or something we want to talk about, or if you want to just unmute and give us.
Yeah, unmute, speak up, or if you want to raise your hand. Yeah, feel free to raise your hand through either way. Let's do it. We got about 12, 15 minutes, you know, 10, 15.
So. For sure.
Yep. Don't be shy.
That's it. Where's the assertive behavior? This is the assertive behavior test. Yeah, stand up and say what you want and ask for what you want. That's part of the deal.
Natria, thank you so much for, that was the book, Words That Sell by Richard Ban, right?
Yep,
thank you. And, you know, the thing that came to mind when I was thinking, you know, during your assertiveness portion is that especially being in the team leader role and working with so many personalities, you know, with agents, I think that comes across sometimes that people think, well, that's going to make me sound cocky. And really, I mean, the listing presentation, I mean, don't turn them off. Don't get me wrong, but it's your time to put modesty in your back pocket.
See, it's right? One of the things it is. And I always say, you know, you have lots of reason to be humble, but no reason to be modest.
Yeah.
Right. In other words, the business will humble us all the time and we could always do it better, but you have to toot your own horn. And the other is that people actually have this mistaken belief that being assertive makes you look cocky or makes you look self-interested it doesn't. Assertive behavior can be incredibly kind and incredibly positive. And you aren't feeling arrogant. You're just stating things in a positive way. Like I had an agent tell me, she said, Dave, I'm so glad. I love that script about I am a master of contracts. She said, I know the real estate business inside and out, but I thought in my listing presentation, I should be talking about all my sales success. And she said, what I really realize is I should talk about what I know. I know contracts. And she said, that gave me the permission to do that. But the way you say it is you say it in a confident way. I'm a master of contracts, right? You don't say I'm better than anybody else at contracts. That would be egocentric. But you say I'm a master of contracts and I've mastered this so I can serve you. So it's always done with that servant attitude.
Dave. Hi, this is Mario.
Hey, Mario.
God bless you, man. Thank you for that wonderful presentation. One of the things about mastering property evaluation, I was like one of your, been told different variety of ways of coming into the home, not preordaining what's going on. How do you handle that pre-evaluation part of the presentation so that the seller actually feels a part of that rather than you showing up and saying, this is what we have? How do you handle that, Dave?
Well, I think it's one is people always ask me, Dave, do you believe in two visits or one? And I believe in one. There's no sense to do the two. And with all the technology we have, Mario, and the ability we have, we can get a real good sense of a property before we even get there, right? So then when we get there, as we walk around the property, you're saying, okay, my job is to make your home more sellable. Let me tell you a few things I think I would really look at here that will make your home more valuable. And now you start to kind of share with them, not in a detailed way, but in a sense of your expertise in staging, right? There's some things I can see, there's probably about 10 things here that will increase the value of your home substantially, right? And we'll talk more about those later. You can even do that kind of a hint thing, right? we don't need to go into details now, but later when we're really talking about getting the highest price for your home, I want to talk with you about some things that I think we can do to make this home more attractive and saleable, right? So I would do that. And I use that time when I first get there and say, well, let's take a little quick tour of the home. I use that time to then do my assessment, right? And also to build rapport with them. And it's kind of, it's interesting. Sherry Puffer, who does in Asheville, North Carolina, does a lot of work with FSBOs and what do you call it when it didn't sell? Come on, somebody help me, the word.
Oh, so expired listings.
There we go, expireds. I couldn't believe I would do it. I did it at a very senior moment.
I know you were just testing us. I got it.
She says, she calls them and says, when can I do a pop by? And they went, well, you know, we're not going to list our home. And she says, oh, I know, I don't want your listing. I just want to help you get it sold. When would I do a pop by? And they go, well, no, we're not going to list our home. No, I understand. I'm not interested in listing your home. I want to help you get it sold, right? It's such a beautiful script. Then she gets there. Then she does the tour of the home and she makes some suggestions and talks with them and they like it. And, you know, about 30% of the time they go, would you sell our home for us? So one of the things to do is use that time to kind of get to know them, but also have them feel your expertise.
Yep. Sandy brought up a great point, and it was one that I wrote down myself, but you had, we're talking about the door knocking when farming a neighborhood, right? Yes. And, you know, and man, from people on this call and others not, and hopefully, you know, watch this recording later, right? They have this fear of like farming the neighborhood because they go, yeah, I don't feel like going up to the door and asking for the sale if they're thinking about buying or selling their home. And I go, good, because that's really not what you should do. And so it was great to hear you, you know, articulate that today, that like, you know, and I forget the gentleman's name, but you know, these door knocks.
He said, I want to make this a better neighborhood. But there's another softer one that I like. It's in my scripts that when people order it, they'll get it. And it goes more like this, knock, 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 you know, hi, Mr. and Mrs. homeowner. By the way, we've been retained by the Smiths down the street to handle the sale of their home. And one of the services we're providing for them is to personally invite you to come to the open house we're having this weekend. And if you know anyone that you would like to move into this area, or if you've talked with them about, please bring them to that. Oh, and by the way, because of the attention we're bringing to this neighborhood, if anyone else needs to sell, this is a great time to do it. Do you know anyone that fits that description? Well, there it is, right? You haven't really asked them whether they want to sell, but you've indicated to them. And it's a service attitude. Again, if it's all the Mr. and Mrs. Smith down the street have retained us, what a great phrase to use right there, have retained us to handle the sale of their home. And one of the services we're providing to them is to personally invite you as a neighbor. See, that feels so strong. And it states a great thing. That's what you do when you service a listing. You talk to the neighbors.
Yep.
I would say to people, always look for what's the highest purpose of why I'm doing what I'm doing. What is the highest purpose? See, Jim, when Jim came and said, you know, I want to make this a better neighborhood. Or if you said, knock, 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 my commitment is to increase the value of homes in this neighborhood and to maximize the amount of money people make when they sell. What one thing could I do to make this a better, a more attractive neighborhood? And they're not even going to hear that. They're going to hear, wow, he's committed to make, you know, to maximizing the value of homes in this area. So always put on for yourself the highest purpose for doing what you're doing.
Any other questions, guys? Take advantage.
Or ahas. We're okay with ahas.
Anybody want to share an aha they were already typing up in their email? Quiet group today.
I appreciate it, my friend. No, I appreciate
it. I have an aha.
You
know that the part of the presentation regarding commission, yes. I really like that. That's a real solid way of presenting our expertise and what we do for our clients and what we do in the field. That was such a well positioned, and I really like that. You know, hey, half of it goes to the people who bring the offer, and the how you broke it down, one, one, and one. It's like, no, I really, and the bottom line, you said you can't cut the last part of it because it's your family.
It's your family. You know, me and my family. That's right. We get, there's only one small portion of it that comes to me and my family. And I certainly wouldn't be right for me to cut that.
And right? who's gonna debate that with you, Dave?
Well, no, well, they'll say, well, somebody else will do it. And you go, well, I don't know how they're viewing their life. This is how I view mine.
That's perfect. Thank you, sir.
You bet.
And, you know, on that point, that is a huge thing. And I apologize about, I'll let you speak up here in a second, but right. The very last slide that you brought up, Dave, I mean, that's why that's so important, right? You have to have that, the most powerful conversation you can have is the one with yourself. You know, do you believe in yourself? You know, because if you don't believe in yourself, that's what's going to come across in your listing presentation.
Well, it is. And then the other part of that, that's why I said it earlier, is, and what can I do to make myself more competent, right? Because what I know is if I really know the market, and if I know the contracts, and if I know staging, and if I've read, and you know, all of Shift, for example, Shift chapters 4 through 9 and chapter 12 is so good because it includes the scripts and dialogues of how we talk about who we are in real estate. If I really mastered all this, then my confidence will be natural, right? I don't have to talk myself into anything. My confidence will be natural. Yep.
Yep.
100%. And that's why you provide, Alex, all the training that you do for the Market Center, because you want people to really build that competence and that confidence to go do what it is. A lot of people try and wing it in real estate. They think they can make it on personality and enthusiasm. And I'm sorry, you can't. That's not, I mean, yes, great to have a good, pleasant personality and to have enthusiasm, but that will not make it in this business. Nope, this is a profession. There is a lot that we need to know to do this well.
I know somebody was about to speak up. I didn't catch who it was though.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
An aha for me today, definitely as a new agent, there's a pretty big fear about what value I have to a client. And you painted a pretty broad picture about how it's not so much about what's behind me, but it's more about what's in front of us, and us being the client and myself.
That's right. What we're trying to accomplish together. That's right. Yeah.
Created a great deal of confidence in me to be able to present that and take it away from the fact that I have no previous, closings. No,
don't even go there. Because the other thing to remember is that you have this massive, powerful company behind you, your own Market Center. Somebody as good as Alex, you have your broker, you have other people that you trust around you. You know you can always get the right answers, right? And just say that to people. You know, one of the things that's really good is I will always get you the right answer.
Exactly. Not just
if I have, you know, that's what Gary, actually that script I did was from Gary Keller. Gary Keller loves the script. He calls it, I'm a professional. I know what I know and I know what I don't. That's Gary's script. By the way, I'm a professional. I know what I know and I know what I don't. And if I know the answer, I'm going to give it to you. And if I don't, I'm going to go get it. And I've got this incredible company behind me that will get the right answers. So you don't have to know everything, right? You don't have to know everything. You've got that great support system around you and use it. Yeah.
And that really boils down to, as long as you have good intentions to take care of that person across the table, like that's really what they're hiring you for.
They are. You can trust me.
You can trust me. Yep.
You can trust me. No, that's
I swear I thought I heard someone else speak up, but just to make sure we get everybody.
It was just me.
Hey.
Hi.
Just me? Is this it? Natria, did you say this is just me?
Yes, just me.
You can't say just me. You can say this is me.
It is
all me. I don't want to hear the just me. I want to hear this is me.
This is me. But one of the things, the aha's from
how do you pronounce your name?
Natria.
I love it. Natria. I love that name. I never heard that before. I love that.
Thank you. Yes, I'm an original.
Well, that for sure. I can tell that.
Absolutely. Well, one of the things that stuck out for me, my aha, is an area where you say the three reasons to list with me.
Yes.
And the very first bullet point that you had about you can trust me, I actually started internalizing it and saying, do I trust me? because I've done the training, I've gone through, you know, classes. Absolutely, I should trust myself enough to tell you that you can trust me. I have to take that internally.
I love it. Yep, good for you. That's the self-talk, right? Yeah. You, that, you know, that, I love that. That is, that's very self-aware and that's very self-disclosing. And thank you for sharing that. Yes, I trust myself. Therefore, you can trust me. Yep.
Absolutely.
Wonderful.
Well, awesome. Well, we are right past the 12:30 mark, but that was amazing, Dave. You are.
Thank you, Alex. Thank you for having me here. Please say hi to Mr. Crouch for me if you see him. If he's just
I know he snuck in the
middle. I know he's just leading a life of leisure now with his 800 children and all that, all the other stuff that's going on.
You know what? I'll give him credit though. He's there when I need him. We had an 8 o'clock with our regional director, you know, so he's been working today for sure.
For sure.
That's awesome. Right,
Merry Christmas, well, Dave. Happy New Year.
Thank you. Thank you. Happy holidays.
Bring on,
Merry
bring on 2021.
There we go. Let's make that year rock. 2021. Let's rock it.
Let's do it, guys. You guys are armed now. So huge shout out to our sponsors again.